Hi, I'm Jason Wasfy. I'm one of the medical directors of the Mass General Physicians Organization. I'm delighted to be here with my cardiology colleague, Moussa Mansour, who is the director of our atrial fibrillation program and an associate professor at Harvard Medical School. I'm excited because this is one of the few two things I know anything about. Moussa, as cardiologists, as you know, we often get called to wonder when people have had strokes and find that they're in atrial fibrillation. I know you're doing a lot around preventing embolic stroke in patients with atrial fibrillation. I'd love to hear more.
So thank you, Jason. As you just mentioned, atrial fibrillation and stroke are closely related. Patients with atrial fibrillation are 5 times more likely to get a stroke than patients without. Unfortunately, atrial fibrillation has become an epidemic in the United States. It is expected that by the year 2050, 15 million people will have atrial fibrillation in the United States.
Wow.
And this is expected to have a huge clinical and economical burden,
yeah,
mostly because of stroke implications. So we've been working on multiple fronts to try to come up with ideas and projects to reduce the chance of stroke in patients with atrial fibrillation. The first project we're working on is to improve or increase the use of oral anticoagulations.
Yeah.
You know, as you know,
yeah,
oral anticoagulations are very effective in stroke prevention. However, many studies have shown that over 40% of the patients with atrial fibrillation who meet criteria for oral anticoagulation are not taking these medications.
Yeah.
And this high percentage,
yeah,
is due to multiple reasons. Some of them, one of the reasons is that providers may not know that the patient has,
yeah,
atrial fibrillation. And in other situations, there is a bleeding that prevents the use of anticoagulation.
Yeah, and then so that's for patients who may have PAF or be in and out of it, and it alerts the provider that they have it. What should we do for patients that we've really gone through it and they cannot take anticoagulation? So, people with a history of subdurals, that kind of thing.
And there are many of these patients. I will talk first about the first part, which is the best practice alert tool that we designed in a multidisciplinary,
yeah,
fashion with multiple groups in the hospital that alerts the healthcare providers when they encounter a patient with atrial fibrillation.
Yeah.
There will be a pop-up screen alerting the provider about the presence of atrial fibrillation and prompting the use of,
yeah,
anticoagulation. We have launched it in cardiology, in neurology, and in the emergency room, and we have been getting extremely good feedback.
Oh, good.
From the people who are using it.
Good.
So regarding your question about what about folks who have bleeding that prevent the use of anticoagulation, we have also started a program called the SEAL program, S-E-A-L. Each of the letters is from stroke prevention in atrial fibrillation. It is a multidisciplinary group. We meet once a month with representatives from neurology and cardiac surgery, and we discuss patients who are referred to us with challenging stroke prevention needs. These are mostly patients who cannot take anticoagulation, and we find the treatment options for them, such as the Watchman left atrial appendage occlusion device that eliminates the need to take blood thinners.
Wow, wow. Well, thank you so much for talking to me about this, and thank you so much for all this work. It's so critically important to our patients. It's a really wonderful opportunity to both improve the quality of care and also reduce unnecessary costs. So thank you so much, Moussa.
Thank you, Jason.